Feathers Left Around, Fleming Stone Mystery Number 7 by Carolyn Wells, narrated by John Rayburn. Knox flung his book across the veranda. Another of those old sealed room plots, he complained, as his host, Valentine Loft, looked up, mildly inquiring. Man dead in an inaccessible room, Knox went on. Doors and windows all locked, no weapon to be found, murder or suicide. And how was it done, if any? The sort I like best, and Loft looked interested. I eat up detective stories, and I like better the how was it done or the who did it kind better than the why. You're dead wrong. The real interest of a murder story lies in the motive. That's the thing. Nope, it's the cleverness of the detail work, the art of the criminal. Now, if I were going to commit a murder, heavens on earth, Val, what are you talking about? Drop it anyway and listen to little Anna. I've thought up a name for this place. Number 2006, Loft groaned. I pray heaven may sometimes send me a guest who does not require my hospitality by offering me a name for my place. The vivacious little blonde who had just come up on the terrace, accompanied by a big, good-natured-looking man, sat on the arm of Loft's chair as she insisted on her suggestion. You'll like this, though, Val. It's different from the stony walls and Ferndales that the herd invents. It's Valhalla. There, how's that? Rotten. Not a bit of it, is it, Ned? And Anna Knox appealed to her husband, whose talk with Loft she had interrupted. Pretty good, he responded. I believe Valhalla means the place of departed spirits, so, in a way, it's appropriate. If you people stay much longer, mine will be entirely departed. But while I've a dram left, I can take a hint. Loft leaned over to touch a bell button. Oh, Val, listen, Anna went on. It's the name, don't you see? Valentine, Val, Hall, Valhalla, Hall. I heard you the first time, and Loft looked at her smilingly. But though I recognized the Val connection, I didn't get the Hall-Hal part till you explained it, almost like a charade. You are the most aggravating thing, and Mrs. Knox favored him with her best pout. Chapter 1, Little Anna. Little Anna was one of the few perfect blondes nature ever turned out. She needed no vanity case. Her face was like that of a grisé pastel. Her shining hair, carelessly tucked up, nestled over her ears in loose, involuntary rings, not at all a rolled-up mass. Dainty of flesh and blood, she was always perfectly togged, and today, in her white-knitted silk sport suit, she seemed a morsel that any man might greedily devour. Ned Knox looked at her adoringly, yet a trifle uneasily, as she lounged nearer to Valentine Loft. "Come here, Anna," he said authoritatively. "Come here and sit by me. Yes, dear, as soon as I make Val consent to my suggestion." She lightly ran her fingers through the thick dark hair of Loft's restless head. "Get out, Anna," he growled. "Get out. I'll murder you." "Come over here, Anna," said Angel Bob Baldwin, the man who had arrived with her. Baldwin was a giant person of the Viking type, and by reason of his calm serenity and frequently upturned blue eyes, was called Angel. "But I've had you all the afternoon," Anna smiled. "I can have Ned all my life, and I can only catch Val in an unoccupied moment now and then, when Pauline doesn't see me. Just for that, you've got to go." And with a calm push, Loft gently dislodged her from her perch, whereupon, nothing dismayed, she went round and sat on the other arm of his chair. But Anna's caprices were always smiled upon, and Loft offered her a cigarette. The veranda gave west, and the disappearing sun touched the flowers, the trees, and Anna's golden hair with a final blaze of glory. None of the three men could keep his eyes off her exquisite...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.